Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Nathan Davis in a moment, but first, our play-by-play call of the day. Kansas gets it done at Fog Allen.
Garrett down the heart of the floor. We'll kick to Dotson on the left wing. He wants another three, and he's going to get it. Devon Dotson's got 21 and 5 3-pointers.
And that helps set up what's coming up on Saturday when Kansas takes on Baylor. Kansas ranked third, Baylor number one right now. Both would be on the one line for the NCAA tournament. That game on Saturday will not change the seeding. Neither one will fall off the one line with a loss. But that will be the game. I think it's at 6 o'clock, I think, on Saturday. And that game will be at the Farrell Center in Waco. We now bring in the outstanding basketball coach at Bucknell, the fastest ever to 100 wins in his Bucknell career. It's Nathan Davis. Coach, welcome. Congratulations on the milestone.
Oh, well, thank you for having me on. It certainly, I think, says a lot about the players we've had and the coaches that I've had the fortune to work with.
What did you like about, you know, obviously you like the fact you won the game last night. How important was it that in a game against Holy Cross, you only gave up 48 last night?
Well, I think we've made some strides defensively in the last month. We're doing a much better job guarding personnel. But anytime you go on the road in February and win a league game is a big deal.
Yeah, it is a big deal. There's no question. You've now won back-to-back games, and you're fighting to get to that sixth spot in the Patriot League. What kind of incentive is that at this time?
You know, I think that obviously you want to finish as high as possible. I think the biggest thing with our league this year is just to be playing well and healthy and confident going in. I don't think the difference between 1 and 10 is going to be that great. And a team that's kind of feeling good about themselves and playing at a high level has got a chance to make a good run.
And no question. I want to ask you about building a team. To me, in college basketball today, when everybody talks about the one and done, to me, the most valuable one-and-dones are actually the fifth-year grad transfers that you can get. I'm talking about the Power 5 level. Mm-hmm. And you know that. You lost one in Nate Sestina. Penn State gained one in Curtis Jones. To me, that's the one-and-done that has become a difference-maker in today's college basketball. You're not in that spot, Nathan. And that, nobody in the Patriot League's in that spot. How tough is it when you can't get yourself older except through natural maturation?
Well, you know, I think that you've seen over the last few years where, especially the higher majors, they start to see the value of that with all the one-and-done to younger kids coming in, that it gives you a guy that you're not tied to for extra years, that's been typically in a program that's won and that played big games. So it's kind of got that leadership going for him. I think from our standpoint, I mean, it just is what it is. Our league's not going to allow you to take them. I think in this environment we have at a school like Bucknell that it would be – I'm not sure how great it would work, because what you do is you do it with guys that are around for 4 years and kind of grow together and learn and mature. So I think there's plus and minuses for it. I mean, it's certainly it's not as a quick a fix when you can't get them. But at the same time, I think we're in a situation where we can continue to grow and attract good players and hopefully be good year in, year out.
What kind of premium does that then put on you as a coaching staff to teach? And also, what does that put on the recruiting part so that you have balanced classes?
Well, I think that certainly you want balanced class. I think the one thing with our situation here at Bucknell and in the league in general is that you're gonna tend to have balanced classes. Now, frankly, we're gonna use the Mesa Senior Starter Kentucky thing as a recruiting tool for us. I mean, I think
it's
great.
Exactly.
Come here, right. And go play at a national power at a high level. He did everything we asked him to do, and we reached out to them when it was obvious, like it was clear he wasn't coming back here. We talked about early on before the year even started, he was gonna go play professionally. He was kind of done with school, and then he thought, well, you know, it might be a better situation for me moving forward in my career to get another year. And so while I was all for it, we did everything we could in our power to help him get to where he wanted to go.
You only have two guys right now that are playing 30-plus minutes, Jimmy Sotos and Andrew Funk. Have you felt good about the way the minutes are balanced, and how fresh are you because of that at this point?
You know, honestly, I haven't, because we've just had so many injuries.
That's a killer.
Four league games where we've had everyone available that we were planning on, that we're hoping to have. And so there's been a lot of guys in and out of lineups with that. We've had obviously some foul issues that's messed with it. So I'm hoping now we can kind of get more settled into rotation that we like and we can all get comfortable with. It's just been between injuries and illness, we just haven't had everyone available. But I'd like to get it. I prefer to play guys where the top guys are playing more like 30, 32 at most. I think that the way we play, it's more effective that way. And hopefully we can get to that point here in the next couple weeks.
How inventive have you had to be at times as a coach with your rotation?
You know, it's been very rarely does it go perfectly. I think that it's just been one of those things, like we had guys that we thought we were going to have and have woken up with 102-degree temperatures the day of the games. We've had to play with it. You know, we got to roll with the punches. I think that fortunately we've got talented guys that have had a chance to play a lot, and it's our job to put them in a position where they can be successful.
Yeah, leadership shows itself in many different ways. One of them is when things aren't perfect. What kind of leadership have you had from a couple of key players on your team when things were not perfect?
You know, I think it's been solid. You can just look at the last week. We weren't playing very well. I should say we weren't playing very well. We weren't making shots, and we lost five in a row. And easily could have hung it up, but came back the last two games to play at a high level. And I think guys have been getting after it. I think practices have been good. And that's so much a big part of it is how do you prepare to win? And we've still been able to do that.
Has that just been it? Shots? Or has it been rebounding? I mean, guys, I'm looking at your numbers. A lot of your numbers are really good along the way. Now, obviously, 42% from the field, that's the one that sticks, but you're 34% in three.
Yeah, I mean, the big thing for us has been, and it's honestly, like, we've shot the three very well, really, all year long. We've not finished well around the basket. We've had a hard time getting the foul line, and so we'll go through stretches where if we aren't making jump shots, we can't score. Even last night we win by 20, but we go from the first media timeout to the second media timeout and don't score and get six good shots. They just don't go in.
We play
Lafayette at home, and we go up two with 7 minutes left and get good shots, but don't make another field goal because they're all jump shots. So we've got to find a way to get to the line more. We've got to finish around the basket more if we're gonna really step it up and play well at the end of the year.
And so, in other words, part of this has been at times, not to generalize, but at times they're not playing enough downhill basketball when you need to get yourself a basket?
I think that's part of it. I mean, we actually have gotten a lot of layups, and it's unbelievable the amount of layups we've missed. And then free throws, we are shooting as a team in league games. In the last 5 minutes of games where we were up five or down five, we're shooting 10 for 30 from the floor.
Right.
And that's tough to overcome. We gotta work to get better shots. We gotta find a way to get to the free throw a little bit more so that we can stem some of those ties and win some of these close games.
Okay, I've done enough games this year where I've done a game with Juwan Howard coaching, Fred Hoiberg coaching, Nate Oates at Alabama, where they want three results offensively. Layup, slam dunk, three, free throw. The mid-range game is eh. Where does the mid-range game in today's game fit into your philosophy right now, Nathan?
You know, I'm all for any I'm big.
You're all
on
for anything
efficiency.
That scores.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'm big on efficiency, and so I think that you need to be getting over a point per possession, or a point per shot.
Yes.
So if you're making half of them, shoot them.
Right.
Know?
Yeah.
We want to make sure we get good shots. If they're 15 feet and we can knock those down, absolutely. I do think the more efficient teams tend to get better standstill threes, get to the free throw line more, and finish at the rim more. And part of why we haven't been as efficient is our finishing at the rim has not been as good as it needs to be. We haven't gotten the free throw line enough. And our pull-up percentage hasn't been great either. So there's a number of things that we can improve on.
What was it like to have Mike Muscala back and also to have some of his teammates back, and how they were received by the public?
You know, it was great. Mike's been, and obviously I didn't get a chance to coach him, but from day one, he's been very supportive of us and the program, follows closely. He's been back on campus now several times that I've been here, and it's exciting to get him back. I thought that it was pretty cool to see how much it meant to him. to be here and to be appreciated the way he was with the turnout and the brunch and the autograph line afterwards. He got a chance to speak to our guys the day before, which was great. It's great to have him around. I mean, he's everything you're trying to sell. He's a basketball program. He's obviously playing at the highest level. He got a great education here. He's appreciated everything that goes on. So he's a great representative of our university and our program.
How much of a selling point, you mentioned Nate Sestina, how much of a selling point is it for you that that Bucknell has an NBA guy and Mike Muscala with the Thunder and Nate Sestina is at Kentucky? What does that mean in terms of what you can talk to somebody about what Bucknell can do for you?
You know, it's huge because it gives us a foot in the door in every aspect. So we have the great education, and we can say, yeah, we got engineers, we've got teachers, we've got lawyers, we've got guys on Wall Street. Oh, yeah, but you want to play at a high level? We got an NBA guy. We got a guy who's playing a big role at a high major school for his fifth year. We've got guys playing in the highest levels in Europe. So if you're really serious about your basketball and academics, this is a school where you can actually point to it and say, look, you can do it all here because somebody has. So it's a tremendous advantage.
Finally, you got a game coming up at Lehigh. Then you got the two-game homestand to close out the regular season.
One game.
Two road games. I'm sorry.
Yes.
Lehigh has won two of its last three. So what are you seeing from them right now?
You know, actually, with getting ready to play Holy Cross the other day, they had just played, so it's the first time I got to see them play all the way through in a while. I think the first thing is they've gotten healthier. They got their big kid back, Karnick, who was playing earlier in the year and missed really the first 10 or so league games and hurt them. I think some of their younger guys are playing with more confidence. I thought they played very well when I watched them play the other day. I think it's going to be a big challenge. Obviously, playing on their court, another February road game in league is going to be tough. And like I said, they've got some pieces that are pretty good, and we got to work it out for us.
Yeah, they're better at home. They're 5-6 at home this year. And that kid's, 12-7, I think, the Cameron kid.
Yeah, he missed a good three, 4 weeks. So
wow.
He's getting back to swing of it now, too. So it will not be easy. We got to work it out for us.
Well, congratulations on the milestone because, you know, I know you give everybody else credit, and I understand that completely, but you earned it. It's your program, and I congratulate you on the milestone. I wish you nothing but the best of luck along the way because I think, I think you're first class all the way.
Well, I appreciate that. Thank you very much.
All right. Nathan Davis, head basketball coach at Bucknell. Penn State tonight in action. Nittany Lions ranked 9th. They will get Illinois in the Jordan Center at 6:30 tonight. Airtime is 6 o'clock. Meanwhile, with the Lehigh games on Eagle 107 with Doug, and that will be, is that Saturday? It's got to be Saturday, right?
Yes. It is 11:30 a.m. pregame, noon tip-off on Sunday the 23rd, actually.
Sunday the 23rd, so they'll actually be opposite us.
Yep. Yeah, so the full week off this week for the Bison, which is much needed to continue to get healthy.
Oh my. I mean, I give Nathan credit because, you know, you have sometimes your best coaching job sometimes is the one where everything is just, you know, he's out, he's sick, he turned an ankle, right? And you've got to be inventive just to keep your team competitive.
Yeah. And he's been about 8 guys in this year. Other than two bench guys that haven't really played a whole lot, it's the rotations have been just crazy. And really, subs are starting, Steve, like pretty much at the first media timeout, 16-minute media timeout just because of all the injuries. And now you don't have Bruce Moore for probably the rest of the year as well, which hurts them. So now you're a little bit shorthanded in the front court. So it's still going to be challenging and a challenging schedule to end the year, too, as you try to sneak into the tournament.
I think the word is for the Bucknell lineup is patchwork. They've had to just adjust and compensate, put guys in maybe before they were ready to play. So Nathan's really, he's sweated it out this year trying to get the right combinations.
I think he's a heck of a coach. I really do. I just think he's a heck of a coach. I think sometimes one of your better coaching jobs happen to be sometimes in years where the record doesn't show it.
Well, and I think this year is one of those years, obviously, for Bucknell. They have never had adversity like this in the last 15 years, probably. Where they've just had injuries and facing a very competitive, tough league now. With a lot of equity in the league. So, you know, the days when Mike Muscala and Joe Wilman, Bryson Johnson, Cameron Ayers really dominated the Patriot League, that's not this year.
Sometimes that happens.
Yeah.
Sometimes that happens. I mean, Roy Williams holding on four. We'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Welcome back. Great to have you with us. Tonight, the Nittany Lions take on Illinois. Jordan Center, 6:30, 6 o'clock will be the airtime here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. We'll have one of the beat writers who covers Illinois from the Champaign-Gazette joining us on the next half hour. And we'll talk about that.
Well, this is a big game, I think, tonight. Wouldn't you agree, Steve? I mean, every game in the Big Ten is a big... But tonight's really an important game.
Oh, it is very important. First of all, you're a game back in the standings.
Right.
You're playing at home. Right? So, and right now, the players can't think about this. The fans can. I mean, you're at the point, you're playing for a seeding right now. You need to keep yourself going and in the conversation. Just keep winning.
Yeah.
Just keep winning. I don't know if DeSumo's playing tonight. He's a game-time decision. And so we'll see.
And that would be certainly nice to see, you know, Penn State on the number two line when they do the NCAA show announcing all the seedings in a few weeks.
Yep. I'm trying to think what the countdown is to that now.
Yeah.
It is, what's today, Wednesday?
Yeah.
So what, 25 days... 24 days, 25 days to decision day, so selection Sunday, that's fine.
And
but, you got to get there first.
Yep.
You know, and you have to embrace what's going on. I think for the fans, I hope this has been fun for them. I think there's also that stress, too, that comes with it that makes it fun for people. Like, oh, you know, they got to keep winning. I mean, that's fun. It's cool.
Oh, yeah. And you can sense in the crowd the adrenaline from the fans who have, you know, just going on a great ride this season. Hasn't happened in a long time at Penn State in basketball.
No. I mean, it hasn't. I mean, this is – but let's be honest about it. This will be – the first time in, well, since they've gone to this system, this will be the first time Penn State's ever gone to the Big Ten tournament where winning X amount of games or winning the tie, whatever was the avenue to get in. They won't be in that position. The only other time they were in that spot was 96, but there was no tournament. I mean, when they went in 91, it's because they won the Atlantic 10. They had to beat Michigan in 2001 to get themselves really in. And then when they beat Michigan State, they got to a 7th seed. And in 2011, they had to get themselves to the championship game to get themselves in. I think when they beat Wisconsin that year in the tournament, they got in. They're not in that spot, but that's irrelevant right now. Right now is, can you win your 21st game? Can you be 11-4? That's what they need to just – that's all they can control is that.
Yeah. Let the rest of it be for people like you and Matt and me to talk about because but for the team.
Have I even talked about it?
No.
I haven't even talked about it.
We've been pressing you a little bit.
I haven't even talked about it. I haven't talked about it because right now, to me, at the moment, it's irrelevant. And the reason it's irrelevant is there's a game tonight. I can't do anything about that other stuff. And I've always – that's one thing after being around – and Joe was a great influence of that – about just controlling what you can control. Right? You can only control what you can control. So if you take that approach, you just worry about tonight. I can't control the other stuff.
No. Nope.
I can't control 10 people in a committee room. I can't do that. So I don't worry about it, think about it, get concerned about it. That's one of the reasons I just haven't talked about it, because I haven't really thought about it.
Well, I can say Matt and I have.
And I will say, I did see, speaking of the two seed, what we want to see Penn State for, Bob.
Yeah.
Fox Sports just came out with their latest projections, and someone did have Penn State as a number two seed. But as you said, Steve, got to keep winning. Starts tonight with Illinois.
And they're in the conversation. That's really important.
Well, and that's what they've done. Now you just got to keep winning.
Yeah.
Just win the next game.
Well, in 2 hours from right about now, Steve, we'll start to find out the answer to tonight's question.
Yep, and it's a good team they're playing tonight.
Yeah.
I mean, I know Illinois had a bad patch, but that's still a good team. They're a very athletic team, too. I mean, Penn State's as athletic as anybody I've seen all season long. You cannot appreciate Penn State's team speed till you see it in person.
Yeah.
But I'll say this, Illinois can move, too. They can move.
And they are dangerous.
And a good offensive rebounding team, too. Back with more after this.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
All right. It's great to have you with us on the show today. The Astros just continue to... But I'll say this, though. All right, you know who's also not holding themselves up in a way? I think the Yankees and the Dodgers now need to cool it. Okay? Guess what? You didn't hit enough, and you didn't feel well enough either. I know they knew what pitches were coming, so that helped the Astros. I got it. But you do know that you can hit, and you can field, and you didn't do enough of it. All right, so just like, you know, like, don't act like the only reason you lost is for that. You lost in part because of that, but you didn't do enough either. You could have overcome it.
Seems like they're coming across with sour grapes, Steve, really.
I mean, after a while, it's like, you stop the whining.
Yeah, you made the point. We all understand it.
Okay,
now get ready for the coming year. Yeah.
Yeah, you got ripped off. I got it. Okay, I got it, look, it's bad for the game. They cheated. There's no doubt about it. But the problem is that, you know, there are other facets of the game. For example, when the Astros were pitching, you didn't hit enough. Okay. When the ball was hit by the Astros, did you do a good enough job fielding it? Or did you commit an error or two that swung a game? Right? You could have also done some things that were within your control and didn't. They seem to discount that. And again, did the Astros have a huge advantage? Absolutely. But let's not discount the fact that you too can do some things. Right? Like you can hit a clutch home run. You can make a great defensive play and kill a rally. You know, you can do that.
Yeah, nothing stopped them from doing that.
Right. I mean, that's part of it. And, you know, I mean, Matt doesn't like that because he's a diehard Yankee fan. But
I'm about ready to move on myself. I think the way it should have been was... players should have been out at once, say their thing, and then let's all just move on. It's time to focus on spring training. First games are Saturday. Let's get going with that.
You know what's interesting? The union got these guys immunity, and yet their own rank and file is speaking out against them.
Well, the fact that the union came out to that I thought was completely wrong. Because if the union wants to continue to have their own thing and have the integrity of the game and all this and that they always say, then they should have allowed this to happen. They should have actually, for once, let their guard down and let the players actually get punished when they're supposed to.
I mean, to be honest with you, the whole group of them, I mean, not all of them, but the guys that are involved in this thing all should have been suspended without pay.
Absolutely.
Right? You want to stop the cheating? Okay?
Yeah.
Suddenly, out of nowhere, you hit them where it hurts, playing and money. You'd be shocked what a deterrent that becomes.
No question.
All right. I mean, in other words, I mean, again, Manfred has not handled this thing well. Right now, he is not on a roll. Okay. But, and he had his hands tied, though, in this. You want to make a point? You're suspended. And guess what? No cash. guess what? The guy thinking about banging the next trash can is going, I don't really think I can risk that. Right?
Oh. When it takes it right out of the old bank account, it's, as you said, Steve, a great deterrent.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, it's the only reason why the suit hasn't been swearing on the air.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
During games. I mean, it's a great deterrent. Okay. Let's bring in Scott now from the Scott Richey from the Champaign Gazette. Scott, welcome. It's great to have you with us on the show.
Thanks for having me on.
Okay. We know Ayo Dosunmu is here, but he was at Rutgers, too. How scary was that against Michigan State? Because, I mean, here it is, the climactic last play of the game, and then that happened.
In the moment, it was probably kind of scary, and I didn't have a great view of it because I was, I sit behind the scores table, and it happened right in front of the Illinois bench, and players and coaches were kind of, blocking me a little bit, but seeing it on, the replay afterwards, I mean, his leg bent in a way that it really shouldn't. So it's probably actually a little surprise to me that, there's no structural damage.
Yeah.
When he got the MRI, just because it looked like kind of one of those classic situations where every ligament in your knee is going to be destroyed. Right. But it wasn't, and he's just... kind of working back from, the kind of still undisclosed left leg injury.
Right.
But the fact that he's up and around, and he moved. I mean, I saw him, saw him Saturday at Rutgers, and he's moving pretty well. Maybe a little bit of a limp, but game time decision today.
Yeah, so. No. Yeah, we all know that. We all.
We'll wait and see. I mean, who knows?
Yeah, but. I mean, who knows? I mean. Look, I'm only happy for him in particular for his future because, look, he has a bright future at the next level. You can see that. With him in the lineup, what is Illinois? With him out of the lineup, what is Illinois?
Well, with him out of the lineup, we got a chance to see what that was like Saturday at Rutgers. And I think, most notably, Illinois just didn't have that guy that could maybe go get a basket on his own. And Andres Feliz can do that some, attacking, the rim.
Mm-hmm.
But
that's right.
I mean, he's kind of at one speed there. I mean, that dribble drives are kind of his strength, and the rest of his game is still probably developing, and it will continue to develop. But Iowa's a guy that can score at all three levels, and can attack the rim, and he finishes really well in transition. But he's got that mid-range game where he can. Hit that pull-up jumper. He's got that three-point shot, even if it's maybe not quite as accurate as it was a year ago. But just a guy that can create for himself was sorely missing against Rutgers, and
right.
I think it's why Illinois had a 6.5-minute stretch where they didn't score at all in the second half, and then kind of a similar one where their only points came on free throws until about the last 45 seconds, Hit a couple shots there late to, cut their deficit to 15. So, I mean, just, but Underwood called him alpha a couple times, since, that game on Saturday. And they didn't have their go-to guy on the court. And also, a leader. I think part of just his leadership skills, not just what he, can do physically on the court, we're also missing.
The one player on this team I have not seen in person yet is Kofi Coburn. Massive man. When you watch him play, what does he bring to the table? And where is he right now compared to even maybe a month ago since the mythical February 1st time has passed for everybody?
Well, I mean, what he brings is, clearly a very big target in the post to get the ball to. And at 7 foot, 290, I mean, he's got the physical nature to him where he can finish strong at the rim. I think what's changed for him just kind of throughout the season and mostly in the last month in Big Ten play is there's a lot of other good bigs in the Big Ten, and he's had to go up against all of them. Luka Garza, Jalen Smith, Xavier Tillman, Daniel Aturu. I mean, just kind of name one after the other. And they're not going to make life easy on him. And Rutgers didn't Saturday. You know, Miles Johnson was very physical against Kofi. And I think his success early in the year in the non-conference, you know, came because he was bigger and stronger than everybody he went up against. Mm-hmm. Now he's kind of got to figure out how to score when that physical, aggressive nature will come back at him 100%. And he's best when he can take his time, not rush through shots, and then you see where he can be a really capable scorer on a low post. When he gets a little rushed, you know, he's a little loose with the ball, that's where the turnovers have come, and that's where maybe the, you know, he tries to go too fast on a finish and doesn't make it. So I think it's still an adjustment for him. As good as he was early, and he was really good, just double-doubles one after the other. I mean, he is just a freshman in college, and different than a lot of freshmen because he's only been playing organized basketball for five-ish years now.
How well has he worked with Georgie Bishanisvili?
It's been a little hit or miss. There are times when, you know, the high-low between with Georgie in the high post, Kofi down low.
Is that, really do you think, Scott, is that in part maybe why Alan Griffin got the start the other day? I mean, just to change it up a little bit?
I mean, a little bit. It was more for Georgie's benefit.
Okay.
And to maybe just settle down just a touch. He's going to play with a lot of emotion, and that's fine. That's who he is.
Exactly.
But I think, you know, Brad Underwood wanted him to temper that just a tad, and I think it worked. He was a little more settled in his play against Rutgers, but he's a really good – Georgie is really good – post-entry passer, just a good passer in general, but he's become a little too casual with his passes, and the turnovers were up. And if Georgie can be settled a little more, he's still just as, you know, much of a weapon as he was a year ago. But there will be times when he backs up Kofi at the five, and there'll be times when they play together. And I think they can still be effective together. It's just been a little more challenging to do that in the Big Ten.
Yeah. What about Trent Frazier? He looks like a guy that, to me, at times can really, like, you know, like go. And then there are times where he struggles with his shot. Are they still concerned about some level of inconsistency where the graph isn't the same all the time?
Yeah, I mean, he had probably his worst shooting performance of the year.
At Rutgers.
Yeah. I mean, just 2 of 13. And on, you know, a day when I would assume was also not playing, I mean, Illinois found it pretty tough to get through that.
Sure.
Trent is still a really good shooter.
Rutgers is really physical the way they play, especially at home. At home, they're very physical.
Yeah, and that's something that Trent Frazier is going to have to contend with always, just because he's not a very big guy. I mean, he's listed as 6'2", sure, but he's slight.
Yeah.
And he's got to work to get open. And, I mean, he's not going to go 1 of 9 from 3.
That's right.
All the time. I think he's still a good shooter. I think just getting him the right shots is important.
Yeah, I agree with you on that. What have you thought of Penn State so far?
I mean, surprise of the one of the I guess one of the surprises of the Big Ten, because I think Rutgers qualifies, Illinois probably qualifies, but I mean, I voted in the media poll before the season, and I didn't have Penn State second. I mean, I'm not even sure I had them in the top half, and what they've done has been really impressive. And I mean, I know, you know, Myron Jones hasn't played the last few games, but just someone taking on, you know, more of a scoring role, and Lamar Stevens not having to do absolutely everything, I think has made a difference for Penn State this year. And doesn't discount what Lamar Stevens can do, because he's obviously had some really good games in this season and through his career, but just giving him some help has worked. And I mean, they're top 10 team in the country right now, and I voted them 9th this week. I think I voted them where they ended up in the AP poll at 9th, and they've earned it with 8 straight wins. So, you know, what Pat Chambers has done there has been impressive.
Scott, thanks so much. Really appreciate your time, and I also appreciate your work very much.
Again, thanks for having me on, and I'm excited for the game. First time at Bryce Jordan.
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Subaru Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you, the other guy's way or the SMC way. The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
All right. Penn State, Illinois tonight in the Jordan Center. It is the all-access game for the coaches. Okay, great. Television comes up with all sorts of innovative ideas.
Yeah. Not one of their brighter ideas, though, Steve. I mean,
you know what? I know they're doing everything they can to bring you inside the game. Now, let me give you one that is inside the game that I like. And that would be the XFL taking you into the replay booth. Good.
Yeah.
I actually have found that to be actually, I haven't watched that much XFL, but I found that to be a little bit different. And it's actually, I think, has been good TV. You feel like you're watching the decision process play out. Other than that, there aren't very many TV innovations I've looked at and go, like for example, Skycam. I like seeing a replay sometimes when it's appropriate from Skycam, and it's a great view. But doing an entire game from Skycam? No.
No. Tedious is the word.
And NBC tried doing that. I'm sitting like, what are you doing? Okay. Pylon cam. Pylon cam's really cool, except for the most part, it's extremely useless. You just see, you see something just flying by you. Hey, great. Perfect. Yeah. I'm glad we have pylon cam.
No, it's, you know, obviously all sports, ESPN in particular, are looking for that next big thing, you know, the umpire cam, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And they're trying to make it better for the viewers. We get all that.
As far as tonight goes, I don't mind the in-game huddle that being mic'd up, because you see that with the NBA on TNT often. But yeah. Locker room, I don't know if I'd feel comfortable with that, even from a fan's perspective.
Well, I mean, the locker room stuff, I mean, every once in a while they'll show in the NCAA tournament, for example. You know, Bruce Pearl before he brings Auburn out. Hey, you know, it's the same old rah-rah speech. Okay, I got it.
Yeah.
Okay, you know, I can't. Excuse me. I've seen the movies, right? And you know how I feel about the rah-rah speech. Hey, go, go, go. Then 15 minutes later, you kick off. At that point, it's sort of worn off.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's one of the great myths, Steve, I think, in sports, that every coach does the win it for the Gipper speech.
Right, exactly.
It does not happen.
Exactly. You know what? James Franklin's not big on it. He's like, he'll say like something before they go out.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, like, I mean, Jack Ham tells a great story about Chuck Knoll. Chuck Knoll comes up, he gathers the entire team around, he says, all right, it's 12:50. We got to be back out in the field at 12:55 for the national anthem. Just be ready. Where's that pregame speech? And they won 4 Super Bowls. And all these people are like, you got to give them the rah-rah smell. Oh, cut me a break.
Steve, I don't know if I've told you my Governor Mark Schweiker story at Bloomsburg University. But the governor was a Bloomsburg graduate and a football player, and he came up when he was the governor of the Commonwealth to give a to see a game, and he asked if he could go in at halftime to the locker room to give a speech. Yeah. And he went in there and gave them hellfire and brimstone to go out in the second half. And I was in there as well watching this. And two of the big stars on the team looked at each other and said, who was that guy?
Well, did I ever tell you that he succeeded Tom Ridge when Ridge became the director of Homeland Security?
I was there when it happened.
So I did a couple of events for Governor Ridge. So Governor Ridge knew who I was. Okay, and I, as a person, I really like Governor Ridge.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right? Well, when Joe won his surpassed Bear Bryant, you know, I announced the game, and one of the TV stations asked me to go out to the field. It was cold that day, to just do a quick interview about what it meant to do Joe's record-breaking game. So I'm walking out, and this guy with a hood and another guy walked by, and he goes, hey, Steve, how are you? I go, hey, how you doing? He kept on going. And the cameraman says, you're kind of cavalier with the director of Homeland Security. I went, oh, God, it was Ridge.
Yeah.
Oh, my God, I didn't even see his face.
Yep.
I felt 2 inches tall. Yep. I'm thinking, oh, yeah, really good, because he's always been so nice to me. I mean, I was nice to him.
Sure.
But I'm just like, hey, pal, how are you? It's like, I'm sorry. That's not really how you do it.
No, but he's a non-assuming guy like that. He would have thought nothing of it.
Oh, no, I'm sure he thought he was perfectly fine with it. Yeah. But I felt, as soon as I was told, I was like, I felt 2 inches tall.
Sure.
Because, A, I liked Tom, and B, right, and I just couldn't see his face. So I was like, hey, how are you?
Yep.
It's like you're some fan in the parking lot I never met before.
Right. Well, Steve, have just a great call starting at 6:30 on WKOK.
Looking forward to it. Should be a good one today. Illinois is, despite what they've done lately, a very good team, but so is Penn State. Time to have some fun in the Jordan Center. We're back an hour from now with the pregame. Tip-off 90 minutes from now. Today's show has been brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. On News Radio 1070 WKOK.